Thank you, Senator Young. Good afternoon, Commissioner. I'm sure that you've heard from many of my colleagues about the concerns about the staffing issue, so I'll try and not be repetitive, but I just want to make the point that I know for the last 6 years, every year the governor's call letter to the agencies asked them to submit their budget with a 0% growth budget, which is, you know, astounding enough as it is. But even in light of that, this agency, somehow or other, after 7 years, is spending $134 million less than it was when the governor first took over, in an agency that is dealing with probably the most vulnerable of our citizenry. And now we have the added complication of the increased minimum wage. And I have said this many, many times. The fact that we even consider this work as minimum wage work is appalling enough as it is. The direct support professionals should be recognized for the fact that they are, in fact, professionals. And we're not taking care of widgets. We're not putting hamburgers in a bag. We're taking care of incredibly vulnerable populations. But we're not providing sufficient resources to this nonprofit sector, who we rely on to take care of our most vulnerable population, to be able to do so and to be able to retain and train and keep these direct support professionals. And the reality is that we're looking at a vacancy rate and a turnover rate in some of these agencies that just in the past 2 years has jumped from 7.76% to 11.8%. Now, I can't imagine that that's not going to get worse. The pressure on these agencies to not just meet the minimum wage, because we're not providing sufficient funds for it, is going to make it even harder. There's the wage compression issue that they're now going to have to deal with. And I foresee a real crisis in this sector if we are not, if we don't adequately provide funding for it. So I'm just curious as to, as the person who's, you know, sent here to justify the budget, how do you guys explain to the governor's office that his demand for a zero growth budget is, one, unrealistic for the population that you're serving here, and two, really does a tremendous disservice to the workforce and the work that they do? I mean, as a state, we can't on one hand say that, you know, working in a fast food restaurant, you know, and taking care of the developmentally disabled are equal work. They are not. They just simply are not. And I think it's time that, you know, we recognize that and we begin to adequately provide funding for the workforce, because if not, we know, you know, I used to be a caseworker, when you disrupt the workforce and you disrupt the care providers, it has a serious effect on the people that you're taking care of. You know, if they're in occupational health, there's a setback. Emotionally, there's a setback. So I'm just curious as to how you think, you know, we're able to provide this type of service to people who really depend upon it with basically no money.
Well, you know, I would say again that, you know, there certainly is a significant investment that's made this year to ensure that we can meet the minimum wage requirements for our providers. I think that's an important step. There is a lot of support in this budget for many types of services, and over the years, we certainly have made investments in this workforce for cost of living. But, you know, certainly we recognize and agree that the direct support professional job is a very, it's a very demanding job, and it is critical to the services that we provide. So we certainly, you know, want to go forward and do everything that we can, looking at compensation and other factors to make sure that the workforce that's needed can be recruited, and that there's good retention in our direct support workforce. I think we certainly would agree with that. We'd want to work with you on that going forward.
Well, I'm sure you believe that. The problem for you, for someone in your position is that your agency is not making that known to the budget counter, the bean counters at the Division of Budget, because they certainly don't realize. They either don't realize it or don't believe it, or they believe that, you know, with a zero growth budget for the past 7 years, that you're able to accomplish all of these things for the most vulnerable population without needing any extra money. And I just don't think that that's, realistic, and I think it becomes incumbent upon you and your team to convince the governor's office that they're wrong, that asking you for a zero growth budget is just unrealistic, unfair, and quite frankly, it's inhumane to the population that you're serving. So while there might be in this budget, and I think that's still debatable, the funding to provide, I'm going to stop soon, for the minimum wage, it doesn't accommodate for what we know as the wage compression issue for the people who are right above it. And that continues to denigrate the workforce, because why would anybody want to stay if they can work somewhere else in a fast food chain restaurant and go home every day after an 8-hour shift and not have to worry about whether or not a consumer that they were taking care of is suffering or not? It, believe me, if it were up to me, I would not want to do this work. You have to worry about the Justice Center, you have to worry about the people you're taking care of. It's just, it's unrealistic to think that we're going to be able to recruit and retain quality people to stay in this job if we don't acknowledge that the work that they're doing. So I just ask that you and those of you who really know this work fight a little harder for the people who really, really need it. Thank you.
Thank you.